Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to First Christian Church. Glad that you are here on this beautiful Sunday morning, our first Sunday in the month of September. Happy Labor Day weekend to everyone. Hope that you're having a good holiday weekend with some fun things yet to come in the next couple of days. We're glad that you're here. Let us know that you are here. You can leave us a comment on the comment section of this live feed, or go to our main Facebook page and leave a comment, or shoot us an email or a text message or a snail mail, whatever works for you. But we'd love to hear from you. Since we can't see you very much, it's great to hear from you in other ways. So if you got a second, we encourage you to do that. I have a number of announcements to share with you. We extend our deepest condolences to Jane Taylor and her family. Jane's husband, Kent, died earlier this week, rather unexpectedly. So we invite you to keep Jane and their family in your prayers as they grieve this tremendous loss of Kent. Services for Kent will be later this week on Thursday at Redmond Funeral Home. Please keep in your prayers Janet Howard, who fell and broke her pelvis this week. Now, you might be thinking, wait, Janet already broke her pelvis. Well, that was Janet Cummings, who broke her pelvis the week before. And then this past week, Janet Howard fell also and broke her pelvis. Oh, I know those two are two peas in a pod, but things need to stop at some line there. So please keep Janet Howard in your prayers as she goes through this time of recovery. Please continue to keep Janet Cummings in your prayers. We've got an update that she's been moved to a facility. Things are going okay, but they're still trying to manage her pain during this recovery as well. So both of them, Janet Howard, Janet Cummings, need our prayers as they go through this difficult time of recovery from falling and breaking their pelvises. Please note that next Sunday, September 13th, we'll kick off our Welcome Sunday. I know it'll look and feel very similar to what we've been doing for the last few months, but we are still going to be intentional about kicking off a new year in the life of the church, as we always do in mid-September. We'll still have 10 a.m. worship services via Facebook Live, but we are going to try to still focus on what we're doing as we come out of the summer months, and how we are going to continue to be the church even amidst a time of pandemic, and in this new quote unquote new year in the life of the church. So that is next Sunday. Also next Sunday, after worship, we're going to have a Zoom coffee fellowship. That'll happen right after our time of worship. We'll bring that up. We'll send out the link so you can just click and log on that way. And then after that, around 11:30, our youth group is going to meet finally once again. We're going to meet here at the church. We're going to be outside in our green space there near the Vesper spot. We're going to keep socially distant, but we're going to find some ways to have some fun and some fellowship for our youth group next Sunday. Look in your snail mail boxes for more information about what will be happening next Sunday at 11:30 here at the church for our youth group. This past Thursday, we kicked off our weekly book study about studying the book Anxious to Talk About It. If you missed out on that, you can still get into it. We're still just right at the beginning. You're not far behind or even really behind at all. So if anybody's interested in being part of that Thursday evening, 7 p.m. Zoom book study, shoot me an email or a text message or give me a call, and we'll get you hooked up and you can be a part of that book study Thursdays at 7 o'clock. We do continue to collect for Stowe Bulldog bags, collecting soap for the next week or so. And then also, because of some gaps that have happened, because churches haven't been meeting over the last several months, we're going to take up a special monetary offering for Stowe Bulldog bags starting next week. for a couple of weeks. There's information in the September issue of the Pathways newsletter about what we're focusing on, but we're hoping that you can find a way to give above and beyond your normal giving and designate that for Stowe Bulldog Bags, how we can help bridge the gap that has been caused by churches not meeting for the past several months. But check out your Pathways for more information about how you can be a part of that. And then lastly, I want to take note that our yoga class will resume this Wednesday, 5:45 down in the gym. There is plenty of room to socially distance for that class. So wear a mask into the class. You won't have to wear it during the class if you don't want to. But we will keep folks distance, and we'll have that class beginning at 5:45 on Wednesday. As always, the bulletin is online, complete with the hymn lyrics for you to follow along and sing along with. Kiddos, today you are going to need some hand sanitizer. You got that, right? Hand sanitizer. And you're going to need a bar of soap. And I brought with me a bar of lava soap. You all have heard of the floor is lava, but maybe you've never heard of lava soap. But maybe your parents or your grandparents, I bet, have definitely heard of lava soap. This stuff's pretty great. But you're going to need soap or hand sanitizer for our children's sermon today. So that's what's going on in the life of our church. There's more information in your bulletin, as well as the September issue of the Pathways newsletter. Please check that out. It should be in your email inbox. There's a link on the website. If you don't get it that way, we can snail mail you a copy as well. So lots of information in that Pathways newsletter. So check it out and see what's going on, how you can be a part of things. But now let us be a part of this time of worship, and let us turn our attention to it through our prelude. I forgot to mention that we have some extra or some new visitors, members of our in-person congregation here. They are some furry, fuzzy creatures that have been placed here in the sanctuary. So whoever did that, thanks for making that happen, especially this pink unicorn right here. I think that might be my favorite one. You don't have to get that joke right there. Chuck gets it. That's all right. So, so on this Labor Day weekend, let us consider how God said, 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord. And Jesus said, come to me all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. On this Labor Day weekend, we come to the house of the Lord from wherever we are, because we are here together in the house of the Lord. And we come here to find rest. rest from our labors. We come into the house of the Lord to find Sabbath with the one whose labor makes our Sabbath possible. So let us consider the work of our Lord, and let us consider the Sabbath and the rest that our Lord calls us to as well. And let us immerse ourselves in the presence of the one who gives us that rest. And let us do so as we worship, and let us continue to worship as we join in singing hymn number 295 in this very room.
Please join with me in prayer. Holy God, we invite you into this place and into all of our homes to be with us as we worship you today. May your presence calm and inspire us. May our songs of praise be pleasing to your ear. Soften our hearts, Lord, and make our minds receptive to your word and teaching. Though we are currently physically separated during our time of worship this morning, may a spirit of Christian fellowship nevertheless bind us together and serve to support each of us as we strive to grow in our faith and walk closer to you. Amen. Like Jonathan said, it's Labor Day weekend, the unofficial end of summer. And like everything else this year, Labor Day is going to look a little bit different. Personally, I'm going to miss heading up to Cleveland with my kids to watch the air show. But we can still grill out, the Indians are still in a pennant race, and we can still enjoy the first hints of the cooler fall weather. And we can still remember what it is that we commemorate on Labor Day. Let's not forget the harsh conditions working people faced as the world industrialized in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, and be thankful that through their struggles, a vision of a better future took root. So we enjoy the worker and workplace protections we have today. God has seen fit to bless our nation in so many ways, not the least of which is the opportunity for so many to improve their lives and the lives of their families through the fruits of their own labor, and in doing so, to contribute to a larger economic engine which has been a great instrument for improving human comfort around the globe. Passing the peace of Christ can take many forms. I like to think that the workers who have helped shape our world so we can live in the material comfort that we do have in some way done just that. So let's be mindful that through our own work, we can do the same and pass the peace of Christ to those around us and to future generations.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will touch your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. All about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it, when it's all about you. All about you, Jesus.
Thank you, Chuck. Thank you, Andrea. Beautiful song, one of my favorites. All right, kiddos, gather around. Have your hand sanitizer or your soap. Chuck's got his. Jacob? Not so much. Those Auckland kids are going to have to show their dad how to make sure he keeps clean. And somebody needs to show my kiddos how to keep clean as well, right? We use soap and hand sanitizer to keep our hands and our bodies clean, and that's really important, right? So what do you do when you come in from playing outside? Maybe you're playing out in your sandbox for a while, like my son is known to do, and you come in and you're gonna have dinner. Do you go straight to the dinner table and start eating? Of course not. What do your parents say? wash your hands. And then what do your parents say? Go wash your hands, right? That's what we say in our house, because you have to say things like that more than once to tell the kiddos to go wash their hands. And so they go and they go to the bathroom, they find the soap, they don't find the lava soap, they find some fragrant, smelly soap, and they wash their hands because it's important to wash your hands before you eat dinner, right? Well, when we do that, we get rid of all the germs and all the dirt that is on our hands, because we don't want to eat with dirty, disgusting, germy hands. We could get sick if we did that. And if we get sick, we don't feel good, and we can't go to school, and we might get others sick, and on and on and on. That's why we use hand sanitizer. That's why we use soap. That's why we take baths and showers to keep ourselves clean, so that we are clean, safe, healthy, and well, right? Now, did you know that what we think can also affect our health as well? This means that we need to be sure that we have clean thoughts as well. Because if we're thinking bad things, especially about others, or we're always criticizing, or we're always being negative or saying bad words, it doesn't make us feel good, and the people around us don't feel good either. So how can we keep our minds clean? Can we take our soap and run it through our brains, or our hand sanitizer, and put it in our hair and have it soak into our brains? Well, that doesn't work, does it, right? But we can, of course, keep our minds clean by praying to God and asking Jesus to fill our minds and our hearts with clean, wonderful things and words that we share with others that are wonderful as well. We can do it by going to church, even if it's just going to church online here on Sunday mornings. That will help keep our hearts and our minds clean as well. And when we are tempted to say something in anger or say something bad, what we can do is we can take a deep breath, let it out, and ask God to help us say something nice, something clean, something that God would have us say. Because in the Bible, Jesus talks about clean hands, because he's asked why his disciples don't clean their hands before they eat. But it was less about not washing their hands, and it was more about finding right traditions. And the right tradition of saying and doing what God would have us do. Now, Jesus, of course, wants us to have clean hands before we sit down to eat our meals. But more importantly, Jesus wants us to have clean thoughts in our minds and in our hearts. So every time you use your hand sanitizer, and I know you're using your hand sanitizer a lot when you are at school, I hope that you'll let your hand sanitizer or your soap remind you that God wants you to, of course, keep your hands clean so that you stay safe, healthy, and well, but that God wants you also to have a clean mind and a clean heart too. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for always caring for us and for keeping us healthy. Help us keep our minds and hearts clean and healthy by following the ways of Jesus. Amen.
Way back in the summer of 1986, my father took me and my brothers to see a documentary film about pilots in the United States Navy. Perhaps you are familiar with this documentary. It is called Top Gun. I know we have some former sailors in the congregation, so I will let them attest to the accuracy of the film, but one thing is for certain. After 6-year-old Jacob saw that movie, he knew he was born to be a Navy fighter pilot, launching F-14 Tomcat fighter jets off nuclear aircraft carriers and blasting Soviet MiGs out of the sky. Now, things didn't turn out that way, but during my senior year of college, I did have the opportunity to earn my private pilot's license through the university. I even got a couple of credit hours for it. The thing about aviation that's relevant to the stewardship challenge this morning is that regardless of what you may have learned in high school physics class, it's not the lift from the wing or thrust from the engine that keeps an airplane aloft. The only thing that keeps an airplane flying is money. So, fresh out of school in my first job, it took a not insignificant portion of my income to scrounge up the money to rent time in an old single-engine Cessna. A far cry from a Mach 2 fighter jet, but at least I was airborne. But it didn't take long for me to realize that if I wanted to realize my financial goals, I was going to need to prioritize my spending. And at that time, a high-cost hobby like aviation just didn't make the cut. In the same way, we as a congregation prioritize our spending so that we can realize our goals and most effectively serve our members, our neighbors, our community, and, of course, God. The church, as always, accepts your gifts, tithes, and offerings through the mail or through the secure electronic giving page linked to from our website.
Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son and give him the glory. Great things he hath done.
Heavenly Father, please accept and bless our gifts to you. Grant us the wisdom to discern how best they can be applied to serve your purpose. Amen.
So Jacob was a Top Gun fighter pilot. That's what I heard there. That's what I heard there. So who knows these things? Unbelievable. Unbelievable. You still got that pilot's license?
No, I'm not current anymore.
Not current anymore. Well, I think we should change that. We should work on that one of these days. That's pretty cool. That's pretty cool. God's word for us today comes from the Gospel of Matthew, the 15th chapter, verses 10 to 28. This is two stories that go together. But it is some Pharisees and some scribes confronting Jesus about some laws and some traditions. And then Jesus, of course, giving them some explanation around that. And then Jesus showing them how to live forth from a new law. And so this is what Matthew tells us in chapter 15. Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached him and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit. Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart comes evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus left that place and went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, Son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "Is it not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs?" She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the good news. Thanks be to God. There's so much to unpack in this text. But the biggest and most apparent eschatological matter at hand is quite obvious, right? I mean, it doesn't take a theologian or a master's of divinity to clearly see that the deep, life-changing, pre-resurrection, faith-filled message Jesus the Messiah is bringing is securely rooted in, say it with me, toilets. You guys didn't say it with me. No? You didn't? You guys didn't see that coming? Then I blame myself, really. If you missed Jesus' potty talk, then I truly have failed you as your pastor, and I hope you will permit me to make amends for my unsatisfactory priesthood and do so by beginning with a conversation about, of all things, high-end toilets, right? You saw that coming. We don't find high-end toilets too much in the United States, but in other parts of the world, they are not uncommon. Just last month, Tokyo made headlines by installing transparent public toilets that feature brightly colored glass that turns opaque when occupied and the door is locked. This high-tech restroom has heated seats, lids that open and close automatically, and at night, these colorful loos light up like beautiful lanterns. This is novel and enchanting, but when it's all said and done, it's still just a toilet. Nonetheless, sanitation issues are an extreme concern anywhere you go, but most especially in third world developing countries. Improper sanitation issues are among the chief causes of ongoing diseases and compounding health issues. That's why the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation has been putting money into funding toilet technology for countries around the world to safely manage their sanitation issues. To spur this technological development, the foundation created an initiative called the Reinvent the Toilet Challenge. I'm not making this stuff up. The University of Colorado received a $780,000 grant to, quote, develop a solar toilet that uses concentrated sunlight directed and focused with a solar dish and concentrator to disinfect liquid solid waste and produce biological charcoal that can be used as a replacement for wood, charcoal, and chemical fertilizers. The California Institute of Technology received a $100,000 grant for designing a solar-powered toilet that generates hydrogen and electricity. The University of Toronto received a $40,000 grant for a toilet that sanitizes feces and urine and recovers resources and clean water. Now, I know what you're thinking here. You're thinking your pastor is still being unsatisfactory in his priesthood by droning on and on about toilets. But hang with me, because believe it or not, this is actually biblical. Jesus himself, in our text for today, mentions the toilet to make a powerful point, which I'll get to in a moment. But first, let's get some context around this, this potty talk. In our text, we encounter Jesus, who has just come from a conversation with Pharisees and scribes who have made a special trip to Jerusalem to confront Jesus about, of all things, hygiene issues related to their traditions. They're from Jerusalem, so everyone knows that this is serious. These are the big boys who show up for major issues, which is always for them Jesus. They ask Jesus, "Why do your disciples break the tradition of the elders? For they do not wash their hands before they eat." Well, Jesus, ever prepared for these type of inquisitions, is all kinds of ready for this. And he's ready this time with some potty talk. To the inquisition of the Pharisees and scribes, Jesus makes an astonishing analogy between a toilet and a wicked heart, saying, "Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes into the sewer?" This is the first part of the metaphor. The word the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible translated as sewer is the Greek word ophidrome. It refers to a place where human waste is dumped. We know this as a toilet. But Jesus' potty talk doesn't end there. He's talking about the waste that goes into toilets, but he's also talking about the vile waste that can be produced in our hearts, in our inner consciousness, with the emotional state of our human nature. From it, quote, "evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. All of these can be defecated, if you will, through the mouth or by our actions, and they pollute everything around us." And it is these, Jesus says in his to his startled audience and to the prim Pharisees around him, "these that are what defile a person. Not that the fact that the hands have not been washed, it's these things that defile." This is not the only time Jesus uses vile references to describe blatant hypocrisy. Later in the same gospel, we read of Jesus addressing the scribes and the Pharisees, yet again pronouncing 6 woes upon them, including these words, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which on the outside look beautiful, but inside they are full of bones of the dead and of all kinds of filth. So you also on the outside look righteous to others, but inside you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness." For Jesus, hypocrisy is vile. It stinks and it needs to be disposed of. Jesus makes it clear in this text and elsewhere in the Gospels that our words, our actions are a product of who we are, of what's really inside us. That's what he means when he says in his Sermon on the Mount that a person who thinks like an adulterer is an adulterer, even if there's been no actual liaison, and that the person who hates another is a murderer, even though a literal murder has not been committed. So how do we get rid of this vileness? Because we need more than just a fancy toilet or some air freshener. We need more than these high-tech toilets with warm seats and lids that go up and down. The good news, though, is that it's available. The good news is that God has already installed the system we need, something so radical and effective that the results are authentic and pure, they're sweet smelling, and they benefit everyone. The Bible calls it a new heart, a new nature. Over and over again, all throughout Scripture, the message is that we are new creations in Christ. The Apostle Paul makes it clear in 2 Corinthians, saying, "So if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has become new. We are reconciled to God. We have been given the ministry of reconciliation." So the question becomes then is, how do we put this new system into operation? Well, that's the really good news, because it's already installed. It's already within us. So it takes a choice, a conscious, intentional, faithful choice to activate it. We must walk in faith, walk with the Spirit-led intentionality that reveals the new life and the new heart and the new nature that's within us. This comes out in how we speak to one another, including strangers, those different from us, those who believe different from us, even those who oppose us. This comes out in how we respond to conflict and how we respond to the needs of others. This comes out in how we choose to respond to the needs and the cries of others, even those who we disagree with. This comes out in how we perceive others, especially those who are different from us. Jesus illustrates what all of this actually looks like. In our text for today, we find the story of Jesus and a Canaanite woman, with an emphasis on her heritage. Canaanite meant pagan and a longtime enemy of the Jewish monotheistic faith. Jesus's encounter with a Canaanite is scandalous as it is, but an encounter with a Canaanite woman, well, that's doubly defiling. The strict behavioral codes of decency, whatever those were in the Near Eastern culture, sternly frowned upon men and women socializing. The brazen approach of this lone woman to Jesus and his disciples makes her character especially questionable then. But the woman is a mother. A mother who has a daughter, and the daughter is sick and she's dying. In an age in which it was a commonly held conviction that all diseases, but most especially demonic possession, resulted from the past sinfulness, this woman's character rating slips even further, and she is seen as lower than low. All of these factors are piling up upon this woman, but she goes to Jesus anyways. And so with this unprecedented scene set, Jesus shows his disciples, and he shows all of us, what it means to live as someone in touch with a law that's higher than the laws and traditions and convictions of human society. No self-respecting and self-righteous person would have had anything to do with this woman, but Jesus does. He forgoes all the rules, all the expectations put in place to keep others in their place, and he takes actions of compassion and grace that created renewed life for this woman, for her daughter, and for those who witnessed it. And that's what we are to do too. With a new system in place, a new nature, a new perspective, we are made to be open for opportunities to reconcile, to share good news, to be gracious and generous, to be kind and compassionate, to break from traditional expectations if need be, so that all people, even those who are shunned by society, are cared for as children of God. Author and pastor Bob Goff has said, Jesus spent his whole life engaging the people most of us have spent our whole lives trying to avoid. I would add, Jesus spent his life living as many of his followers say they live, but don't. Living as children of God is an intentional lifestyle choice. We choose God. We say yes every day to God. We resist the inclination of our basest instincts, choosing to walk in faith, becoming stronger and better at it the more we do it. But to live this kind of life, we must become aware of our hypocrisy, which is what Jesus is pointing out to the Pharisees and the scribes. They want to keep up appearances by following traditions and rules, even though they are exclusionary. But Jesus is far more interested in living out rightness and justice and faithfulness. He's far more interested in healing and inclusion and compassion. These are the new rules and the new traditions Jesus is establishing. This text is less about washing our hands before eating, which is certainly important and not a practice Jesus is dismissing, and it's more about living faithfully into God's call for our lives. Jesus wants us to worry less about traditions and the way it has always been, and focus more on whether we are presenting ourselves to God and our sisters and brothers as someone who is real, someone who cares, someone who is Christ-like, someone who doesn't look at labels and traditions and prejudices, but instead embraces an authentic new life, new nature, and a new creation that we are, and that we offer that to all those around us, offering it as the scent of gracious and loving acceptance. Because anything else, says Jesus in a manner of speaking, is just potty talk. Amen. Friends, let us join together and go to God through our prayers. Let us pray. Creator God, oh, how we give thanks for your work to make all things new. You are forever seeking for your will to be done on earth, and are always at work to make it so, most especially through those who follow you. You yearn for all creation to live in harmony. Invite us to be part of that redeeming and life-giving work. The work can be so overwhelming and even impossible, though. But when we read your holy word, we see how your Son did and how we can too. Jesus reached across the ethnic boundaries between Samaritan, Roman, Canaanite, and Jew. Jesus offered fresh sight to the blind and freedom to captives. Jesus breaks down barriers in our community, enabling us to see the reality of racism and bigotry, hypocrisy and exclusion. And Jesus calls us to free ourselves from the ways and traditions that keep others from the newness you offer, challenging us to uproot ourselves and our society from systems that keep others from the new life you offer to all. Persistent and loving God, forgive us. Forgive us for growing weary of the struggle for peace and justice and for courting despair. Forgive us for being convinced we know who is in and who is out of your family, as if your care is not for all of us. Forgive us for wanting people to be like us before we help them. Forgive us, then reconcile us to those who have been treated as less than or unwanted. Mold us into a community where all your children are accepted, included, and loved. Loosen our need to see the full results, and instead know that small acts can have huge effects. Sustain us with an abundance of faith that implores our willingness to do the loving thing and be faithful in the small acts of caring. God of the hidden seed and the promised resurrection, work your surprising and amazing grace in our lives and in our broken world. May your work to make all things new continue, and may it continue through each one of us. Hear now the prayers of our hearts offered in this time of holy silence. All this we pray in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, let us gather together wherever we are around our Lord's table to share in the act of Holy Communion.
Of joy we sing around your table, Lord. Again our grateful tribute bring, our solemn vows record. Here do we see your face and feel your presence here. So may the savor of your grace in word and life appear. self-forgetting love, be our communion shown. Until we join the church above and know as we are known.
Each time we step to this table, we are reminded of Jesus' call for us to be a new creation. We are reminded of the Apostle Paul's words that we have been reconciled. Each time we step to this table and partake of these elements, the bread of life and the cup of salvation, we take into our very bodies, our hearts, our minds, our spirits, that which does not defile, but that which creates the opportunity for new life. But taking in these elements cannot be where it ends. We must take in these elements and then go forth from this table ready to share with all that word of new creation, that word of new life, that word of new opportunity to be reconciled themselves. So let all who hear Jesus' voice imploring them to come to him, let them come to this table just as they are, knowing that we are unclean, knowing that we are in need of the forgiveness that this table offers. Let us hear that invitation. Let us receive again the promise of new life, of new creation, and let us then go forth ready to share it with others. For it was on that night before Jesus was crucified that he gathered with his disciples to share with them a meal. And it was during that meal he took a loaf of bread and he blessed it and broke it. And he gave it to them saying, "Take and eat of this, all of you. For this bread represents my broken body, broken for you. Take and eat of it and do this in remembrance of me." In like manner, Jesus took a cup, and he gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "Take and drink from this, all of you. For this cup represents my shed blood, poured out for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink and do this in remembrance of me." Friends, let us come to this table. Let us receive these elements, for these elements are transformed into gifts. They are the gifts of God for the children of God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we break bread this morning, like you did with your disciples that night so many years ago, we ask you to bless our communion elements. We recognize this act of communion represents a gift we do not deserve and can never repay. The best we can do is to thank you, Lord, for your sacrifice, which has reconciled us to you, and in the spirit of that reconciliation, to love others as you first loved us. Amen.
Jesus is always inviting. We know this, but we can't hear it enough because we need to be reminded, not just on Sundays, but every day, that Jesus is inviting us to draw closer to him in what we say and what we do and how we reveal him to others. So let us hear again that invitation. Let us carry that invitation with others to draw closer to Jesus. And should there be any among us wanting to draw closer to Jesus in that special and unique way through a confession of faith, we invite you to make that known to us, and we will reach out to you and we will follow up more about your response to Jesus' invitation. But let us consider that invitation, all of us, as we join together in singing our hymn of invitation, number 517, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Let us sing. Say and do, an opportunity to draw closer to the Christ that is within us, so that the Christ that's in them can be found and revealed. And that is done through our words and through our actions. And may the words and actions of our minds and hearts, may they always be acceptable to our Lord, to our God, to our Creator, to our Savior. And should someone take note of that, and they likely will, let us be ready to share with them an opportunity so that they can begin to uncover that which is within them. Maybe it's by joining us here on Facebook Live some Sunday morning or checking out our YouTube videos. But let us be ready to share with them that opportunity to know that the Christ is within them and that it can be uncovered. So as you go forth to share that opportunity, may the grace of God, the constant and abiding presence of the Holy Spirit, And the unconditional love of Jesus Christ rest and abide with each and every one of you, now and forevermore. Amen.
Dismiss us with your blessing. Fill our hearts with joy and peace. Let us each your love possessing triumph in redeeming grace. Oh, refresh us, traveling through this wilderness. Thanks we give and adoration for your gospel's joyful sound. May the fruits of your salvation in our hearts and lives abound. Ever faithful to the truth.